This journey takes us to Russia, but this journey is just the last part of a 2-year quest to adopt a young girl. Russian streets are full of exhaust pollution, and our quest lay choking in the Russian system for many months until we got the green light to proceed. Paperwork in hand, my wife pumped our adoption rep, Sasha, for answers. As spring dawned in St. Petersburg, our hopes bloomed as well. We sped through downtown traffic. Our driver and our rep were both named Sasha.
How many days to St. Petersburg here?
Traffic is always heavy in this lovely city. We stayed in the heart at a small bed and breakfast inn. Sasha helped us unload our baggage. St. Petersburg is crisscrossed with many canals, surprising me. I felt like we were in Venice. Grand fountains adorn quaint parks at recurring intervals, emphasizing the beauty of the town. Our first day, we try to familiarize ourselves with the layout and walk the pavement, making up for the hours we spent sitting in airplanes. Eye candy greets us everywhere, and we reach for our cameras. We visit a cathedral in the process of restoration. Inside, the utter completeness of artwork and craftsmanship is spread over virtually every inch of the walls, floor, and ceiling. I am astounded. Mentally calculating how long it took Michelangelo to paint the Sistine Chapel, I guess that the number of artists assigned this project must have numbered in the hundreds, and each superbly talented. Tours showcase this grand work to hundreds each day. At our inn, we are treated royally and meet another American couple in the process of adopting. We have breakfast with them. Then our adoption hostess takes us to visit Liliana at her orphanage on the outskirts of town. The orphanage is a converted boarding school, and not all kids are orphaned. Some have parents who lose parental rights or have parents who can't afford to house their children. Lily comes rushing to meet us. It's been 2 years since we last saw her and began this process. A social worker watches emotionlessly from the office. Lily's friends doubted we were ever going to come. Older girls can have bleak hopes of adoption. Lily can at last prove we exist.
All the time.
Lily shows us the office phone where we shared conversations over the many months. No privacy for her. Now she takes us up to her room. We glimpse her life and see the other children who live here. Her room is fun, and her two roommates are her best friends. She shows us the pictures she kept of us. We take Lily to the director to see if she can spend time with us prior to the official adoption. We hope she can even stay with us, but she still has several days of school left. So our hopes are dashed. As bleak as the place is, all around is the glow of dandelions, suggesting to me that life here may be harsh, but nature always offers hope of fresh beginnings. I can see how the Russian poets were inspired by Russian springs. We have permission to take Lily to dinner, and that's all for today, as we head back to St. Petersburg to find a restaurant. Instead of a traditional Russian dinner, Lily wants pizza, much to our disappointment. Next day we cannot see Lily, but we have business to attend. We must have Russian physicals to prove we can survive parenthood, despite our American physicals that say we are healthy. We spend the entire day in a clinic. When we emerge, it is raining. Then the weather changes again and allows us to walk to a splendid restaurant. The cuisine is fabulous. Especially the salads raised in the land of the midnight sun. We walk back to the inn well past 10 o'clock, and yet the sun has not set. We find memorials to the siege of St. Petersburg and stroll through lovely walkways, winding through elegant parks. The Church of the Savior on Blood commemorates the spot where Tsar Alexander II was assassinated. And we relax at a playground, contemplating the child we are adding to our family. Thank you. The next day is the last day of school for Lily, and we arrive early so we can see the graduation program. Lily dresses in her finest. The other children file in and take their seats. I pray that they will have the fortune of loving parents someday. After the program, Lily poses with her roommates, Dasha and Valya. There are no tearful farewells, only smiles when the school year ends for the summer break. Returning to downtown, we walk towards the largest cathedral in the city, St. Isaac's Cathedral. It's the biggest gold-plated dome in the world. We climb the stairs for a spectacular view of the city and the Neva River. Then we descend via a spiral staircase for an equally incredible view of the cathedral's interior. Afterward, we meet Galina, the director of the orphanage when we first met Lily 2 years ago. Galina and Lily stayed at our home for 6 weeks that summer, and we became close friends. She has a van and takes us out for a ride through the city. We dine again, this time salads and chicken. Our second visit came several weeks later, and this was our final step in the adoption journey. But because the G8 summit took place in St. Petersburg, we had to fly to Moscow with plans to take the train for the last leg of our return. Another Sasha greets us at the airport. And the boyfriend is an entrepreneurial guy who is rebuilding an exotic car. His engine parts share the boot of the car we ride around in. It smells of oil and gasoline. We make hasty plans for our stopover. We have several hours to kill, and we take in some sightseeing.
Building, selling, buying and selling buildings.
They take us to Red Square, and I'm humbled by what this place has meant in history. As a child of the Cold War, I cannot believe we are standing here. Lenin's tomb is closed, alas. Don't know where George Harrison is buried. And yet another Sasha greets us with our itinerary and the remaining days of our Russian adoption journey. Teens practice bike stunts, irrespective of the crowds around them. This is a kind of a wishing well. If you pitch your ruble into the crevice and it stays, your wish is granted. We marvel at the exquisite statues and fountains flanking the square. The statues depict literary events like Lita and the Swan. A slow drive through Moscow provides us with a welcoming of fireworks. The city glitters, and I find what I was taught about Russia wanting when compared to reality. Then it's time to board the overnight train to St. Petersburg. Our host help us load our bags and we are underway on a relaxing ride in a sleeping car. Arriving the next morning in St. Petersburg, we realize how tense we are. This is the day we face a Russian judge who holds the fate of our daughter in her hands. We're concerned because older teens just don't get adopted. It's unthinkable most of the time. We try to cash in on our jet lag. Then it's off to the courtroom. They wouldn't let me videotape the procedure, but our judge coldly listened to Ermgard express our desire for Lily to be our daughter. Speaking is hard because we have to wait for the interpreter to translate for us, and then wait in the judge's responses to be translated. The judge makes notes and listens to the orphanage director. He enthusiastically approves the idea. And of course, I have a few words to contribute, but things are not going well. The judge hones in on a minor detail in the paperwork and mistakenly believes after-school childcare is our entire budget that we spend on feeding and caring for the kids. The bailiff asks a few hard questions, and we think he figures it out. The orphanage director again goes to bat for us, and we're very grateful for his support. The judge calls Lily to testify. Lily explains she has no family left who can or will support her. Lily expresses her desire forcefully and respectfully. These court hearings usually last a half hour. Ours stretches out to almost 3 hours. But at last we're granted parental rights. As we wait for the documents to be drawn up, we sit weary. Then we're presented with the legal papers and receive explanations what each means. Lily must have a new passport made, and we marvel at the ancient camera this photographer used. We learn that there are two passports issued in Russia. A local one suffices as driver's license and identification, and an international one certifies authority to travel. We have to get both, and of course that means visiting several places. And of course nothing is free, so we visit a bank for more cash. Then the glorious day beckons us to take a canal tour of St. Pete. The guide passionately explains the history behind what we see, but only in Russian. Lily ponders what will become of her. She is torn with her love of Russia and the possibility of new life. We glide across the Neva River. When Peter the Great reclaimed the lands along the Neva River in 1703, he decided to build a fort to protect the area from possible attack by the Swedish Army and Navy. In the middle of this fortress stands the impressive Peter and Paul Cathedral, the burial place of all the Russian emperors and empresses, from Peter the Great to Alexander III. The cathedral was the first church in the city to be built of stone, and its design is curiously unusual for a Russian Orthodox church. Lily wants Valya to come with us on a day trip to the Summer Palace. We hire a driver and guide and begin our visit. First stop along the way is Peterstadt, home of Tsar Peter III. The grounds are impressive.